It is 12:30 in Jakarta. It is 8:30 in St. Petersburg. It is 10:30 in the morning in Los Angeles, California. It is 6:30 here in London. Welcome to wherever you are. Hello, welcome, ladies and gentlemen. My name's Andrew Maxwell. What a show we have for you. We will have comedians live through the internet from all over the planet. This show is a first, ladies and gentlemen. It's a mixture of stand-up, chat show, and long-distance relationship. This is what I'm excited about. All us comedians, we get in late at night, and we're all obsessed with weird stories from around the world. Like the town of Mostar in the former Yugoslavia. This town was riven in half during the Civil War. One side of the town, Croat, the other side, Bosniak. When they finally rebuilt their bridge, they were given some money for a peace statue. But the people of Mostar couldn't decide what they all had in common. So they built a giant golden statue of Bruce Lee. Fair enough. I came in late one night to see that there'd been an earthquake in New Zealand. Not the tragic one we all heard about. One a couple of years beforehand where nobody died. But being New Zealand, they still had to have a Kiwi response to it. They put a camera in front of this lady at what was 3 a.m. our time and they went, "Can you tell us what it's like there?" And this lady went, "Oh, it's absolute disaster." So a table of apples got tipped over. Oh, New Zealand. What do you think, ladies and gentlemen? Shall we get our first brave comedian from around the world onto the show? Yeah. All right. Welcome all the way from Jakarta, Saktia Maruf. How are you feeling?
I'm feeling great. I mean, thank you. Thanks so much for having me. I'm like 3,000 miles away from London, which obviously as close as I can get to a member of the opposite sex. I cannot believe that BBC can arrange a show that is this Islamic.
And neither can the Daily Mail. So, Indonesia isn't in the British or Irish news or European news. We don't know a lot about it. We've heard of Java, we've heard of Bali, we've heard of orangutans. Long story short, tell us a little bit about what's it like in Indonesia?
We're basically fourth largest population in the world, and we are a country with the largest Muslim population. Please don't get too intimidated by that. We're basically safe. We are also third, fourth largest Facebook and Twitter user. And they have been giving a very good hand to a few radical Muslims to really spread their hate message against the West. So yeah, thank you, Facebook.
Is there any taboo topics that, you know, that can't be crossed in Indonesia?
Everything. I mean, even orangutan is taboo. At least before Leonardo DiCaprio came visit.
What did Leonardo DiCaprio do to the orangutan?
Are you kidding me? Taking selfies, of course. He's done some great job campaigning about saving the forest from basically the greed of palm oil industry. And that's when the government decided talking about orangutan is also taboo.
Oh, wow. Well, here, we don't talk about ginger people either. We've asked members of our audience to come up with some questions about your beautiful fourth largest population country on planet Earth.
Yeah.
This is from Brigitte. This will give you some sort of insight into how British and Irish people's minds work.
Okay. That sounds like a test.
What's the weather like there today?
Well, to sound sophisticated, I will say partly cloudy.
Oh, that's how we like it. I have to say, I was very, very briefly once in Jakarta. I was taking a flight down from here down to Australia, and I stopped off for about...
Oh, my God, congratulations on behalf of our Minister of Tourism.
Thank you. then it was 3 a.m. and I got out of the airport and it was like the hottest day in Irish history at 3 a.m. I was like, where's the heat coming from? The moon? This is from Barry Adams.
Yeah.
This is his question about Indonesia. Where is it?
Well, do you know where Australia is?
Yes.
Near Australia.
Near us, or more importantly, Australia's near Indonesia. This next question is from Winnie. Okay. Winnie, over to you.
Hello. My boyfriend and I are travelling to Australia via Asia, including Indonesia. And we wondered if you had any tips for us.
Well, if you only go through Indonesia, just be sure don't eat spicy food. You need to arrive safely without stomach ache in Australia, so...
So I think we should have some stand-up. What do you think? Are you ready to?
Yay!
Over to you. Ladies and gentlemen, will you please welcome live from Jakarta, our first stand-up of the evening, Saktia Maruf!
So, as mentioned earlier, Indonesia is a country with the largest Muslim population in the world. And we also are a country with abundant natural resources, vast tropical forests, oil and gas, of course, for us to be able to relate to other Muslim countries, and teak wood, bamboo, all different kinds of trees, which give me this idea of recommending Indonesian jihadists to stop using guns. Well, because it's too American. And to start using Indonesian weapon, the bambu runcing, we call it, sharpened bamboo stick. This will definitely earn them a better image than other terrorists, because then they can brand their action with eco-terrorism. We hate you, but we love the environment. And people must have think that it is hard to live as a Muslim woman in many countries, perhaps in the Middle East or even in Indonesia. However, if I can tell you something, we do have many freedoms as well growing up as a Muslim woman. For example, we're not supposed to get physical with the opposite sex, not even shaking hands. So freedom from germ. And also, we're supposed to look down and we're not supposed to look at men in the eye. So there, freedom to observe men from below their waist. And you might have heard about early marriage, arranged marriage among Muslim community. Well, we do have freedom though. Freedom to choose between marrying your cousin or richer neighbor. And so there, freedom of choice basically based on below the waist measurement. I'm single, 34 now, way past expiration date for men in my community. So I guess I'm stuck with continuing my education and having a career. Many of my friends, and this is a true story, many of my friends got married at the age of 16 and dropped out of high school. I'm very fortunate that my parents supported my education with so many conditions that I wish I had a lawyer to help me negotiate. For example, I'm not allowed to participate in any student organizations or extracurricular activities. I'm not allowed to speak up. Most importantly, I am not supposed to know anyone from the opposite sex, let alone date them. In the past, I thought, wow, I didn't know that my dad was such a great supporter of lesbianism. Thank you. Signing up.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.